Welcome to Let's Not Play the Bureau XCOM Declassified, but the ending is amazing. A, shall we say, discussion postmortem podcast thing for a game you probably haven't heard of, and probably, or if you have, it's you probably don't care about it that much, but I personally find it interesting, and I hope my guests find it interesting as well. Joining me is Oblivious and Azureink.
Hello.
Hello.
I guess to start this off, we should probably say this will be pretty nakedly spoilery territory for the game The Bureau XCOM Declassified, which, if you don't know, is a spin-off to the XCOM series that is not a tactical, not a strategy game, but a tactical third-person shooter. Think Mass Effect. And you've basically got the whole gist right there.
My god, it's full of stars.
But
well, there is a spaceship that you fly around in.
there technically is, yes. Anyway, so the reason why we're calling this Let's Not Play is because originally I was creating a Let's Play for my YouTube channel of this game, The Bureau, and we got about, I'd say, about 40% into the game.
And then we
tanked it. That was not funny.
And we just, I mean, it was, I was making it very thorough and very in-depth. I was getting, like, just about all the dialogue I could find. I was separating out optional dialogue to keep the pace up in the main videos. I was, for our commentary tracks, I was creating cut and uncut versions so that there's a version of the video where we're not talking over cutscenes and the version of the video where we are, which was a whole nother layer of work. So between recording the footage, editing the footage for commentary, editing the footage after commentary, for this, like, 10-hour game, at least, just an absurd amount of work. And the game was... The thing about a Let's Play, at least I believe, is that, especially when you're a D-list YouTuber like me, the only thing driving you forward is passion. So even if you if you're Let's Playing a game you love, you're going to hate it by the end. If you put that much work into it. And The Bureau is just not a game I found that I love that much. So we got about 40% in. I just could not push myself forward. And I just kind of decided to scrap it. Which I felt was not totally fair to you guys, who were my guests. But just...
Well, we're not famous D-list celebrities, so nobody is turning in to hear our blabbering.
Well, I mean, you know, it sucked that happened, but also in fairness to Spud, I was switching jobs at the time, and I was actually falling asleep in the middle of the recording.
Oh yeah, so
that was lack of
unprofessional. You had all, different.
All around, we were not bringing our A game. The funny thing is, after I took the videos down, I had some people comment like, "Oh man, but I was really enjoying that series." And their profile, I did not recognize it from any of the comment sections of the previous videos, most of which had zero comments. So I was like, "Great, wish I'd known, buddy."
Well, I was not funny.
It's a weird thing that I've noticed on the internet, because there's a lot of people that lurk around and just watch, and usually, like, your most supportive fan base are really, really quiet. It's kind of creepy.
A little bit, yeah. I mean, and personally, I'm one of those people. I'm a lurker everywhere, so I totally get that. But, you know, when I'm trying to make the decision, well, do I want to keep going on with this project? And the fact that there are zero comments on most of the videos, I kind of have to take that into account, you know?
Fair enough.
You know, it becomes not like the deciding thing, but a factor when you're weighing everything.
It doesn't help.
Yeah. So, figure...
Mystery.
So, you know, it's like, no, you know, barely anyone's watching it. It's not that entertaining for me, for them, for... The game's... This might be giving the game away, but most of the game, 80% of it, is really just kind of mediocre. So...
At least the dialogue is good.
I wouldn't say that. Like, as someone who does a lot of writing, the dialogue's not terribly exciting. It's functional, but there's also a lot of, like, exposition and instructional text that really doesn't.
Sorry, I really like that bland.
You know what? For you, that doesn't
back and
that,
forth.
That really doesn't surprise me, and I do not mean that as a dig. Just as
no,
your personality, that makes actually a lot of sense that you would really enjoy that. And I guess if you want like a lot of people in the '60s being very businesslike and dry, that's totally your thing. But comparing it to something like Mass Effect, especially, and also just a lot of the writing that I like, you know. With dialogue, I was just like, oh, okay, we've been over this like 3 times already.
I think it's more accurate to say that the writing might be what it is, but you know, I don't think anybody actually like phoned in their performances or anything like that.
No, I wouldn't say that either. I think as far as the acting goes, everyone just kind of did their jobs and followed their character direction.
It's workmanlike.
To the letter. It's just that a lot of the characters are cliches, but we'll get to that. We will focus on a lot of the story stuff a bit later.
We'll get to the good parts later.
The bad and the good parts, yeah. So I'd like to talk a little bit about sort of the history of this game, because I find it kind of interesting considering how the game turned out. Basically, this... The Bureau XCOM Declassified is the end result of the XCOM like shooter project. Some people may remember at E3 2010, 2K unveiled simply XCOM, just XCOM, and the video was for clearly a first person shooter set in the 50s with this sort of, I guess I'd call it, you know, what shadows lurk in the heart of suburbia aesthetic.
And it was called a betrayal.
Yeah, it the backlash was insane.
Well, he was specifically quoting Spoonie on that one because he actually
That's right.
I think he actually got banned from certain press events for doing that.
Right. But to be fair, as someone who has played the original, I myself don't really care the fact that they decided to go this way instead of with the strategy route, because thankfully we got Enemy Unknown and now XCOM 2.
Yeah, but at the
enough job.
And that's like that's like the happy ending to that story, because at the time, 2010, XCOM became kind of a flag for people on the warpath against publishers that were recycling old IPs as shooters just to make a profit appeal to a much broader audience. It's like, you know, one of several that I can think of, just Syndicate, Dungeon.
The old Syndicate?
Yeah, the old Syndicate versus the new Syndicate.
It's a very similar thing in which you're taking a strategy / RPG like game and turning it into a third person shooter.
Yeah.
Well, first person for Syndicate, but
yeah, the FPS thing sticks because that's, you know, you were either Call of Duty or Gears of War, and at that point in time in the game industry, a lot of stuff was just that. And it was getting on the nerves of people who were like, oh, look at my old beloved strategy IP. What are you doing? So that was kind of like a turning point in the development history. But there's a really interesting article out there called The Many Faces of the Bureau XCOM Declassified from 2006 to 2013 on Polygon.com. And it's written like right before the release. And it's just this very long history about Take-Two Interactive and just the many studios that were dealing with this project even before and after that pivotal 2010 event. 2K Australian, 2K Marin, just shuffling around a bunch. Irrational Games was also kind of part of it before they split off to do Bioshock Infinite. Important like studio leads left the project at critical moments, causing sort of leadership vacuums. Getting 2K Marin and 2K Australia to communicate was just a problem that never got solved for most of the work time. And the game just went through creative reboot after creative reboot, just testing ideas that not working out until kind of after Enemy Unknown released, things kind of got galvanized a bit more. Like, it's like, okay, well, we got to have sectoids now because Enemy Unknown made it so there have to be sectoids now. And, okay, so now we'll have, like, the cover mechanics and all that stuff from Enemy Unknown, so we can finally finish this project. It's coming together. Let's get it out the door. You know,
it's like a snake eating itself.
By 2012, you know, became less of a game development project and more of a cleanup crew. You know, just like, we gotta make something of this. All the work that's been put into it. And that's...
I think they delivered pretty well, given what they were...
Yeah, that causes me to be a lot more charitable to the Bureau XCOM Declassified. You know, it does some interesting things, but there's also, like, a lot of inconsistencies, some plot holes that really kind of say, oh, this game really was stitched together from whatever, you know, they had. They had to cut a lot of stuff. They just did not have time to really flesh out a lot of stuff.
Oh, well, as someone who didn't either know this or just, like, assumed the best, I guess, I did not notice any of that. I thought
it would have been...
I thought it overall...
We didn't get to some of the more glaring plot holes.
Ah,
okay. Particularly one in, like, chapter, I want to say, 4 or 5, chapter 4, I think. Where mm-hmm. there is this alien general that you have to go and capture, and everyone's saying, "Oh, you better capture Axis! You better capture Axis! Better take him alive! Don't kill him! Oh crap! Angela Weaver just took the Sky Ranger. She's gonna go kill him. Go and stop her." Then you get to the end of the mission, and you got him on his knees, and it's like, "Okay, it's over, Axis. We're gonna bring you in." Angela Weaver's like, "Oh." Will she shoot him? Will she not? There's a moment of that. And then the final shots of that mission cutscene are her shooting him and William Carter, the main character, walking away, kind of wincing, going, ah, crap. But then when you go back to the base visit afterwards, they're like, okay, good job, Carter. We got the data. And just like, what? There's no transition. Like, apparently... that moment where he was on his knees was apparently enough, but they don't say that because everything building up to this was don't kill him. Please capture him. Don't kill him.
Did we do that one?
We didn't do that. We didn't get to that. We didn't get to that in the LP. Just
could have sworn we did something similar.
We did the base visit leading up to that, but then we went off to do side ops. Weaver just flew the coop. Nah, I'm just going to take care of some side ops first.
It's like, wait a moment. Several hours later. Okay.
All right, now
it's RPG logic right there.
Yep. It's like, that's like the big one where it's like, oh, okay, you could have handled that a little better. But just this yeah.
Just let it out, Spud. Let it out. That's what this whole thing is for.
It really is. We haven't talked much about the game itself yet. Just everything around it, I guess.
Well, I can say this much about the game: despite it and Spud's best efforts, it is not Mass Effect.
This will be in a lot of the footage I put up too. I named all of my squad members after just like every male Mass Effect cast member I could find, because you can't have female agents in your squad
because the 60s.
Because it's 50s or something. It was the 60s, yeah.
Which is not with Fallout, but. That was another time before the aliens attacked. I mean, the nukes fell because of the aliens.
Sure. But, which made it really hard because I eventually had to use what's the fan's name? Werner. I had to use Werner as one of my squaddies because I was running out of male, Mass Effect, recognizable male Mass Effect characters.
Really?
like ones that would be more recognizable, but anyway.
Yeah. Mothership Zeta.
Well, Werner is recognizable, but for mostly the wrong reasons.
Exactly. But anyway, so we just talked a bunch about the history of the Bureau XCOM Declassified. I didn't know this when I got the game. I was just somebody who had played Enemy Unknown and saw this, and I was like, you know, when I was playing Enemy Unknown, I would have kind of liked to be able to walk around the base and actually talk to people, physically walk around and talk to people. I would have liked to actually be doing the shootings that I, you know, if I'm doing the shooting, maybe I wouldn't miss on an 87% chance. I don't know.
Unless it was like some of those like first person RPGs in which you don't have enough gun skill or whatever, and so even though you're like point blank range looking at their head or whatever, it like pulls to like it like shoots right past them, clips through it.
Yeah,
you don't have enough.
No, this is just I kind of describe it as Mass Effect 2.5, but not great.
Right.
Mass Effect 2.5 with less polish.
Yeah, exactly. It's feels so like it definitely feels like
point or like maybe it's like 0.5 Mass Effect. Is there like a Mass Effect scaling of like
the spectrum of Mass Effect?
It's not even a 1 on the Mass Effect scale. It's
well,
like
it's I feel like it's
5 or something.
I feel like it's more than 1 because it's very clearly more based off of 2.
Oh, you're talking about Mass Effects 1, 2, and
yeah, 3. It's not as agile as 3, but it's not quite as sticky as 2. Yeah. I guess I don't know.
That's kind of... on a scale of Jenkins to Shepard, it's a Werner.
That's pretty good.
Thanks, I try.
But yeah, so I got the game being like, oh well, you know, if it's like XCOM, but I get to walk around and actually shoot things myself, that's pretty good. The problem is, it's if you're expecting like an XCOM game where you have base management and random elements and stuff like that, there's no randomness whatsoever. It tells a linear story instead. Everything is the same on every playthrough. So, and all you can do is really change the difficulty. You can customize your squaddies. And
kinda.
There's not a whole lot of options there.
Well, that's interesting because this sounds a lot like the kind of back and forth that me and my brother have had for years. Like, you know, because we both play games a lot, right? And he's more of an FPS guy and I'm more, you know, RPG guy. So naturally we have some design disagreements, and this sounds a lot like all the back and forth conversations we've had over the years.
I'd say that the Bureau is a result of a lot of back and forth conversations about game design, where they kind of had to make compromises a lot.
Yeah, it's definitely a game of compromises for better or for worse.
Yeah. In my outline, I have the gameplay, the good parts, and I'm like, what are those?
The drinking scene.
We had fun with that.
Oh man, like I love.
But that's not something that you do. You just press accept.
No, that's really more of a.
Over and over again.
I'd say that's really more of a story moment.
Press X to drink, and you can do it like what 5 or something times.
Yeah, 5 times.
Oh, it's showing it right now.
It and in the live stream I'm doing, it's.
That's awesome.
It'll probably be playing when I edit this together in post as well.
Excellent.
That's perfect timing, actually. But anyway, I think the good parts of the Bureau's gameplay, I think in general the shooting is pretty okay. In fact, pretty good. I'd say like when it comes down to just you shooting guns at enemies, the enemies are coming a pretty interesting variety as well. Like the mutons are like serious trouble. You have the commanders are kind of samey, but. I mean, they're basically shielded guys with one special power, so... But, you've got drones, which are there to ruin your day.
Actually reminded me of the newer Halos. The drones.
Kinda, yeah.
although they don't pick the guys up as far as I can remember.
I'd say that those parts are pretty good in general. The system, the battle focus system where you can give commands is also kind of interesting, but it sometimes it just takes a while to get things out, especially when you have like 10 powers that you need to fire off all at once.
Well, honestly, the most interesting thing about the gameplay is the gameplay and story integration.
Yeah. Well, I guess I now I'm wondering, like, what exactly do you mean by that? You want to clarify?
By integration, I'm talking about like how it relates to the plot and all that, specifically like how you command your squad and just how you're able to do, you know, be able to face all these waves with fewer men, you know.
I think that's getting into the ending is amazing, but
it is but I'm saying that that's probably the most interesting part about it.
Again, we're talking about a thing that kind of elevates the whole game when you really think about it, but we should save that for we're getting there. We're almost to that part.
But, you know, speaking just of the gameplay specifically, I haven't played it myself, but I mean, it seems well and competent enough. I don't think I would have been too dissatisfied with it.
Well, I like the shooting. I like the enemies. I like in general the mechanics there, but like everything around the shooting that's gameplay related, I feel like kind of lets it down. Like,
so you really like the shooting, but not the shooting.
Well, let me. I've got like a list of like very specific points here.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Like the character progression, you know, you level up your characters, your squad, and whatnot. But it's basically almost linear. There's a couple points where you pick between two options, but for the most part, it's just, you know, you go down a line. Congratulations, which is par for the course for an XCOM game, I guess. But I don't know. It feels kind of disappointing when it's very clearly more like a Mass Effect thing.
Well, it's. That's one of the things that it's like, well, you can't fault them for that because that's almost
in general, a lot of my complaints can be summed up as the parts that are like Mass Effect take away from XCOM and the parts that are XCOM take away from the Mass Effect. it's this unholy fusion that doesn't quite make those two things meld. The guns in general, like, despite, you know,
I was going to make a peanut butter and chocolate reference, but then you said it doesn't really go together, so
yeah,
I don't know what is the equivalent of that.
Oil and water,
mayonnaise, and oh, okay. Oil and water. Yeah,
the guns are like, as far as shooters go, they're pretty basic and not exciting. Like, it does the XCOM thing of you start out with, you know, human ballistic weapons, then you get laser, then plasma, what do you do? But like, for a third person shooter, I guess it, you know, need a bit more variety than that. The guns all basically kind of are the same.
They don't have any weight to them.
No, especially on higher difficulties where you're just, there's this flanking damage mechanic where the damage you deal to somebody is modified by whether they're in cover. Like, you'll do like 60% damage, or if you have them flanked, you'll do like 285% damage per shot. But it's counterintuitive.
It's not noticeable.
Like, it's very plainly on the screen, like when you do battle focus and then like command.
But it doesn't feel like it.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like it because you see it when you command your squaddies to shoot somebody, which I've noticed they kind of really don't do any damage if you don't give them the fire command. It's like you can't just leave them alone. You have to be micromanaging everything they do. There's a lot of moments where a grenade lands near them and they don't move away from it properly.
Okay. They don't have the AI that, say, the Star Wars Clone War clone...
Republic Commando? Or
Republic Commando. There we go.
Yeah, if you...
That one has, like, probably the best squad AI
of any game. I think it has the best communication of what your AI partners are doing.
Right.
And yeah, the AI is competent enough to make them feel like they are really helping, but it also has a lot of feedback to tell you, hey, I'm doing this thing. Hey, I did it.
Yeah. Yeah, but they don't, like, die instantly if you don't pay attention to them and all that other stuff.
Yeah, the AI is not great in the Bureau. That flanking damage mechanic's counterintuitive, and you don't really want to take advantage of that, because if you move too far ahead, your soldiers get killed a lot more easily. It's much easier, especially on Commander difficulty, which I was doing the Let's Play on, to just sit back at the start of the encounter map and just fling your powers at them every 90 seconds.
And plus, I noticed that a lot of the enemies are just bullet sponges. It's kind of artificial difficulty on the higher stuff.
Yeah, I mean, that's probably my mistake. I did some rounds on Squatty, the normal difficulty. And if you're going to play this game at all, you might as well just do that, because then the combat won't be a chore. But
right, it's artificial
difficulty. But you also won't be forced to make the most of your tactics either, so... You can just shoot everything regularly, like Mass Effect.
Fair enough.
Anyway, I have such a masochistic relationship with this game. It's ridiculous. I must play on Commander difficulty. I have to.
You've been doing that a lot lately.
I have.
Is that hard? Is that
there's a rookie, squatty, veteran, and commander.
Okay, so commander is supposedly the hardest.
It is, especially because that also scales up. Damage and enemy health as well.
Right.
But also what it does is it changes when and where you can recruit new guys, because the game assumes that you will be losing them fairly frequently. So they're like, oh, if your guys die in battle, you have to wait until you're at a resupply or between missions or on Commander. It's like you can only get new guys when you're back at base. So if you lose your guys mid-mission, well, you're out of luck. The problem being, at least for me, that I was really good at not letting my guys die. So I had the end of the game, and I had like a baker's dozen level 5 squad mates, of which I could take 2 with 4 classes between them.
Damn it, I'm running out of Mass Effect names.
Exactly! I had 13 guys, and I had to give them all Mass Effect names. I could only use the guys. Mm.
Yes, and unlike the, say, original XCOM, where you could have upwards of, I think you could get, like, what, 12 to 24 people?
Because you needed that many.
Yeah, you don't get that kind of thing in the more recent XCOM games.
Which?
The Enemy Unknown.
Which, I like that. Worth
6, yeah. But... I like, you're like that, but I want all of them.
I like that personally because I don't know. I don't think I could do original XCOM just as a scrub, because I like how six is streamlined.
It was
streamlined.
Really, really hard. It was like Nintendo hard.
Yeah, so that's like the one thing everybody knows about.
I can barely do that anymore. I used to be able to way back in the day when I was young and impressionable. And now I can't do it anymore.
It's so unfair is part of the problem.
Yeah.
Like, you get screwed over so easily in the original one.
That's true. Grenade at turn 1 before you can even act, and your entire squad is dead.
No, what's even worse is that when you get the chance to move first, but you mess up your grenade, and then it's all your fault.
Right.
That's the worst.
Yikes. But yeah, the game threatens to permakill your squad mates at pretty much every difficulty. And what it changes on top of that is, like, how fast they bleed out and how easy it is to revive them. And on Commander difficulty, what happens is your squad mates don't get back up and get back to fighting. They just get stabilized and stay on the ground for the rest of the fight. They don't die, but they just can't fight for a little while longer. And going from veteran to commander, I had the weird experience where I thought that was actually kind of easier, because it meant that they weren't just popping up and down like, you know, moles and whack-a-mole machine.
Like daisies!
Yeah. Like, okay, got you back up, and you're dead again. Ugh, I gotta revive you so you don't perma-die, but, ugh. So when on commander, I was having the experience of, okay, you're stabilized, and wow, no one's shooting at you. All right, I can take the rest of these guys by myself. You know, it's not like you guys were doing that much anyway.
And that's why the best power is the silicoid.
Silicoid. Later you get a drone, which you can give a heal of its own. And then just the lift that Carter gets is just completely overpowered.
Just like in Mass Effect 1.
Yeah. I like Mass Effect's lift better because it actually ragdolls people.
And you can combine powers with it later.
Yeah. In the Bureau, it's just they go straight up and hover there, which is, I feel like, less impressive. And what else? Yeah, in the end game, when you have everyone at high level, everyone's got like 3, 4, 5 powers they can throw out. The beginning of every combat takes forever because you can deploy 10 powers at once. And on the higher difficulties, you kind of have to.
Right. Because everything happens really quick.
Yeah.
They drop the silicoid, get the turret on, go ahead and do the orbital targeting, the all this stuff.
Throw the mine, throw the scatter, put up a turret, critical strike.
Lift this guy up.
And then the things I wasn't doing was actually getting my guys to actually start shooting things. I just have them throw their powers out, and then they just plink away at cover or something. So I should have been doing even more than I was doing. But, and then...
Can't aim. It's an XCOM trait.
Yeah. I mean, the result screens of every mission, it'd be like, Carter, 108 kills, the other two guys, 4, 7. Like, their powers are essential. It's just those are the only things they got going for them.
So basically what you're saying is that the stats looked a lot like when I was playing multiplayer with you in Mass Effect 3 for the first time.
I don't think I was carrying that heavily.
It felt that way.
I did have a lot of really overpowered kits, I will be fair. What else can I complain about the gameplay? The backpacks.
Most of them are useless.
Most of them, you get the gunner pack, which gives you increased clip size, increased maximum ammo, and reduces damage from enemy fire. Yeah, there's the tactician pack, which gives you reduced damage and increases power range, which is better suited for your squad mates. And you get those within the first 2 chapters of the game. Then you can get like 20 more, which is like increased damage against enemies with low health, increased damage against shields, against armor. Increased headshot damage. Like, all these, like, single perk things, and then you have the gunner and tactician packs, which are multiple perk things. So, they immediately outclass everything else, and the backpacks just don't feel like a very well-thought-out addition.
I mean, they could have been, but the problem is they didn't, they made them all situational, with rare exception.
And the thing, and you can change at resupply stations with that stuff, but you'd also have to know ahead of time what you're going up against. And I guess you could reload if your main guy dies, you just reload the whole thing anyway. You can't have the XCOM situation where your whole party is wiped.
Well, that's what happens when it goes third person.
Yep. So. Gosh, I lost my train of thought, but...
Backpacks. Were not a great addition, because there was only 2 that made any sense, and the rest of them were not so good.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm curious about something.
All the guns were also very similar.
Yeah.
Just slight upgrades.
Like, the very, very, very end game weapons actually had some interesting stuff, but... Everything leading up to that was just like, here's the laser SMG, here's the laser shotgun, here's the laser rifle, and then plasma. Okay. It's like, okay, here's an actual minigun, here's this rifle that does a bit of burning damage, here's this lightning cannon, which would have been, you know, really interesting to get to in the LP. But, like, that's...
Oblivious, you had a question.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Oh, I just wanted to know, speaking of the things that can happen in combat and all that, did they ever bring in things like panicking and all that stuff too, or did they just go down?
I don't remember seeing any of that.
No panic.
None he was playing. I mean, they'll like yell things, but they won't actually like panic.
Oh yeah, one thing that kept happening. Oh god.
Din just linked it. Just linked a thing.
Bubba made another spud image.
Yep.
I'm gonna have to save that and put that in the video now because
that was
now
from the last stream thing that you did.
I missed that.
And saved.
All right. I have to put that in the video now because we talked about it so much. All right.
Sorry.
So it's not that it felt like power creep. It's just that the situations, it was always just a shootout. And
What are you supposed to do? Talk to them?
But
yeah, that would have been interesting.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, they already have something like that. It's called Undertale. This is not Undertale. But...
Oh, shoot, they did some of that in Mass Effect where it's like you're not going to shoot us, are you? It's like, no, only if I have to.
That's another thing. The missions, by the way, here's a challenge for you. You played Mass Effect, you know, 2, right? Name a mission that takes an entire hour. That is a whole hour long.
You mean itself without, you know, having to respawn all the time?
Yeah.
I'm thinking maybe like the later collector missions, maybe.
Maybe they take like 40 minutes at their worst. Yeah, but
I mean, I don't think any of them actually reach an hour, but most of them aren't that long to begin with.
Yeah.
I assume the very last thing that you do.
The suicide mission in Mass Effect 2 might be actually.
I put air quotes in it because I never lost anyone. And
I did a run where I worked hard to lose everybody.
Oh, really?
While still having a save I could import to Mass Effect 3. It was a challenge. I'm a psycho.
Indeed.
But anyway, the game...
The point is they don't last that long.
But the main missions in the Bureau regularly take, like, an entire hour on Commander, anyway. Just, they take forever. On Normal, that it's maybe more like 45 minutes, but the main point being those missions are just a marathon of just a ton of combat encounters, a ton of dialogue, a ton of in-between stuff, which isn't that great. Like, it tries to do the Mass Effect thing where between shootouts you're walking to the next one and there is some story on the way. Or tries. There's someone on the radio that talks.
So what you're saying is you might have finished the Bureau with our normal commentary if you had played on an easier difficulty.
No, because it wasn't the playing that was the hard part. I'd gotten Commander difficulty down. I died like maybe twice in the whole thing.
Right.
Like
I don't mean to derail the thing again, but why did you open up the Wikipedia thing?
The what?
I think this is a part of the video that he's streaming.
Oh yeah, I was trying to name the other character, and
okay,
right.
I was just wondering why the Mass Effect...
This is uncut stuff that we didn't see.
Yep. I wouldn't have left that in the video if I was editing together the LP. But yeah, I would sometimes hop off to the Mass Effect wiki in the Steam browser to be like, okay, I need to name another one of these frickin' characters. Oh crap, it's the Russian. I guess I'll name him after that guy in the Omega DLC in Mass Effect 3. Because he had a vaguely Russian-sounding name.
Oh yeah, that guy. Oh shit, it's been forever since I played that.
Oleg Petrovsky. Anyway, but yeah, so you have the in-between stories thing, but usually it's just someone talking on radio at you, telling you something new or something you already know. The times where it does try to tell, like, a story of, like, the environment, you know, about sort of 1962 suburbia and random people slowly discovering that aliens are, you know, subverting that area, you know, or invading or something. And the problem is with the recordings and the documents that you find, it's always the same story. Like, it's basically the five stages every single time. Stage one, it's a lovely day in 1962. Stage two, you start getting signs that something's a bit weird, something's a bit off, you know. Someone's starting to show signs of the sleepwalker infection. They're repeating what they say. Stage three is the, oh, shit, aliens moment. You know, where things start really going to hell. Sometimes you get the rare stage four where you have someone who's going to be like, okay, there's aliens everywhere. I'm going to take a stand or make a break for it or something. And then stage five is always everyone's dead or brainwashed. Good job. That's it. You don't get to. You rarely get to talk to anyone who actually survives.
Because I usually don't.
What did you think about the missions in, well, like the, there's like a map that you activate to do your missions, and you can send people to the different things. What did you think of that?
Right. It's got a bit of that Assassin's Creed Brotherhood thing where there's map missions that you can send people off to, and that's basically what you do with your extra guys to level them up. And it's in the beginning it's a little tricky to actually get all of them done for like the achievement, but towards the end it's like you have a bunch of level 5 guys and it's like, okay, there we go, because you take two with you on your missions and then you send the rest on whatever is left on the map,
and they level up really fast,
and they get at least one guaranteed level, sometimes two, from doing that. So again, nice. By the time you hit the end of the game, if you've been doing that diligently, you have a baker's dozen fully upgraded guys, and you take two of them onto the final mission.
Well, doesn't the base get attacked or something? Maybe they're all sure that the base doesn't die.
No, everyone abandons the base at that.
Oh, okay. Well, escorting refugees.
Well, you still have the full suite of them to select from when you're gearing up for the final mission, so I'm assuming they're all on the ship with you.
Oh, okay.
Like, that's your crew, basically.
Your Carter's heroes.
Yeah.
Well, kinda.
So, I guess we're kind of fully in story territory now.
I'm making a Hogan's heroes line, basically.
I knew what you were referring to, but we're coming up on the point where that's not really relevant.
Right. Are you going to give them a show of that?
A show of?
On the stream.
A show of what?
Of the twist as we're talking about it?
Yeah, I'll pull up the prisoner video or something.
Okay.
Once we get around to that. We're not. Gotcha. I still want to talk about stuff that's not about that yet.
Okay.
We talked about the mid-mission subplots.
Yeah, we still got a couple talking points.
So we've talked about visiting the base, right?
We haven't yet, actually.
Oh, we haven't. Okay.
So the other half, or really like the other like 60% of the game that's not the shooting missions, are the base visits, which is basically like all the, you know, all the points where you could walk around the Normandy in Mass Effect and talk to your crew. It's basically that, but it's a hole in the ground.
it is, and then Carter displays his superpower of carrying a room's worth of recording equipment to play all the tapes around the room.
Oh yeah, you find these big giant reels that are apparently audio logs, but you don't have any equipment to play them. It just gets beamed into your mind.
I think he just touches it.
Yeah, he just touches it and it starts playing magically there on the table.
Well, it probably makes sense when the twist happens that it's the twist that causes it to work.
It probably still doesn't. Like, why is it sitting out there? Why is it on this desk in particular? Why is it in this diner? Why is it in this burning building? Why is it always the same model of the reel?
Maybe the aliens really like that. Like,
No, that's the real twist. All the aliens are like just terrible hipsters, and they like
they're old media enthusiasts.
It's like, oh, screw this, we're going, it's either, like, oh,
it's either that or they recording tapes.
They really have an unholy obsession with Betamax.
Yeah, I was gonna say they don't even have VHS, they just use Betamax and laser discs and stuff. And I'm pretty sure half the people watching the stream don't even know what any of that is.
That's, I think it works better that way.
Well, it's like the spy films, except for instead of microfilm, it's the big stuff. They haven't learned how to miniaturize it yet.
Yeah.
I was honestly waiting for a moment to say this recording will self-destruct in so-and-so. So I would have loved to see those big reels do that.
Yeah, the game takes itself a bit too seriously for that, though. Whiskey scene aside. I swear, that whiskey scene, it's
best
like
part of the game.
It really is, because that, besides like the ending, which is amazing, we'll talk about that, but like after that's about 4 hours into the game, after a 4 hour slog, that moment is just, oh, it's so good, because it just
descends deeper and deeper into his drunken state.
Isn't he like doubled over behind his desk by the time the whole thing's over with?
Yeah, he just gets up from like the floor, and it's and the other two people were like, "You were supposed to be drinking with us. You realize that, right?" And he's like, "Oh, I was drinking with a friend."
No, they were basically asking him like, "Why didn't you share her?" or whatever. He's like, "But I was drinking with someone." Because he was basically drinking with all of his like fallen comrades and
future. What strikes me about that moment, and we'll get to that later, I think it's actually a weirdly placed moment of foreshadowing, if you think about it.
Fair enough.
Well, there's also like, because they talk about it throughout the game, like his flashbacks and all his stuff. You know,
Carter's a troubled man. Yeah.
Yeah, he's clearly got some form of what do you call it? It just flew out of my head.
Death wish.
Well, I mean, maybe a little bit of death seeker, but I was thinking like some kind of like post trauma thing.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe something. I don't know. I'm not a psychologist.
The whole dynamic of William Carter is that, because like the pivotal moment of his life is that he was in deep cover in the CIA. And then he came back after like a year undercover to find out that his family had burned down in a house fire. And so he alternates blaming himself and blaming his superiors, who basically, you know,
survivor's guilt.
Yeah.
What I was thinking of.
Yeah.
I was like, I can't think of the word.
Survivor's guilt on a grand scale. And so he develops a drinking problem, disrespect of authority. We're getting into characters now, and
then stuff happens. Dialogue trees are reversed from Mass Effect.
that's right.
They're on the right side to get information, on the left side to continue, instead of the other way around.
That's how we're setting ourselves apart from Mass Effect. We're gonna flip this shit.
We're gonna flip the dialogue tree around so that you have to. It's.
Damn you, muscle memory.
It's such a small point, but boy, did it throw me off the first time I played. Like, okay, let's investigate. I can't go back? What?
It's kind of hard to tell what you're getting when you're, like, looking at the dialogue trees as well. Mass Effect also had a similar problem, where you're like, okay, I'm going to click this, and then he says something completely different.
It's a weakness of that style of dialogue tree, certainly, where you have the summaries, and then it expands to this full line that from your character that doesn't always perfectly match up, but I'm kind of too in love with Mass Effect to really complain about that too much.
Well, I was just going to say, I noticed that you developed a habit as times went on where you would spin the conversation wheel critical thing to make sure you didn't do that. It's like, oh, wait, different game. I got to make sure I pick the right one.
I just like doing that in general, just spinning it around.
Oh, I thought that's why you were doing that.
It's also a good check to make sure it's like, okay, I'm not clicking before or after this. I'm not clicking prematurely.
Because it looked like a nervous tick thing or something.
It probably is. If we're being honest, it probably is.
Because I have that same problem in RPGs. And you know, in Mass Effect, I did the same thing where I was just spinning it because it was fun. It's like, wee! And my brother caught me doing it one time. He's like, what are you, 12? Yes, for that moment, I am.
So, but yeah, the characters in the Bureau, I kind of have a major beef with, because a lot of the characters are incredibly cliche, I'd say. You've got a German Dr. Heinrich. You've got Myron Falk, who's this very no-nonsense man in charge. Weaver's, you know, very stern woman making her way in a man's world.
Very, very not compromising either.
Yeah. And William Carter, who's this sort of CIA detective, hard-boiled with, you know, drinking problem and tragic past.
And then you got Dr. Weir, who's a lot the more idealist of the scientists.
Yeah, the idealistic scientist, as compared to the pure scientist that is Heinrich Dresner.
And, you know, your mileage might vary on any of those. But yeah, we've seen a lot of them before.
Which, I mean,
which is not necessarily a bad thing.
But when you go to cliche, you have to kind of do something else with it rather than just play it straight, I think. And this is just, it's kind of just kind of played straight.
Just make him more likable, at least.
Yeah.
You know,
Myron is a dictator and paranoid and really doesn't. Weaver is just always angry and doesn't warm up to Carter until like the very end.
Did they ever mention that he was supposed to be part of the CIA, but he got flipped to this instead? Because he strikes me as one of those guys.
Actually, the Bureau really seems like more his baby. Like he's kind of set up early on as like he was the only one who believed in the whole outsider thing, and everyone else was skeptical.
which brings up another
weird plot hole thing.
Uh-oh.
Like, so the Bureau XCOM Declassified is set up as you've played Enemy Unknown, now here is the secret history, the origin story of XCOM, right? But really all the lines you get for that is this was the Bureau of Emergency Operations and Command for a Soviet invasion, but here we're repurposing it for an alien invasion in Falk's like, okay, survive, adapt, win, welcome to XCOM. And that's establishment. Okay, we are now XCOM. Like, This was very clearly a different thing that was not XCOM. Did you just rename it on the spot? Which I guess he did, but...
Well, I don't know. You know how it was back in the day where everything was X something? Like Project X? Chemical X?
Yeah, but... Like, I would have expected someone in the audience to be like, sir, what's XCOM? Because he states it so confidently, like, that is, like, welcome to XCOM.
It is COM that is X.
Yeah.
Command.
I think they were all just scared.
So it gives the impression that, like, oh, I guess XCOM is already established. This isn't an origin story, except it kind of is, and it's just not, like, as far as that angle is concerned, if that's your expectation, it's kind of a letdown.
It's not very organic.
Yeah. Because, I mean, in the 2010 trailer, there was this sort of, I guess, proposal that the game would be more about investigating this first contact and XCOM being established as they do research and realize, oh, we're dealing with something from beyond our world. We got to build something to deal with this. Where in this game, it's more about, okay, we are XCOM, let's go fight them now. You know, like Enemy Unknown.
And the source of frustration.
A little bit. It's for how the game kind of gets bogged down in the gameplay, the story sometimes just jumps forward in weird rhythms.
Sorry, I'm just mesmerized by what we're watching right now.
Oh yeah, the whole, let's...
You're like looking at some sort of orange things.
There are these side quests in the base visits, which are basically either really miniature puzzles or just walk around, talk to specific people. And walking around the base visit is super slow. You can't run or sprint. So, and
just sort of jog.
You just sort of jog through it, and the base can be very huge. And then there are these side quests you can do that sometimes unlock, like, extra... I guess call them outer ops, but basically dispatch missions, where you send your guys off to do an extra thing while you're off doing a main mission.
You have to do the intermissions to do the outer missions.
Yeah, but those get you backpacks primarily or extra guys, which again, you have little need of either. And some of them just don't really have any consequence at all. It's just like, you did, here was a fun little distraction.
Have an achievement.
Yeah. Here's the achievement for clearing all of the base investigations. Good job.
Yeah.
The game tries to do like, oh, you better get all the extra stuff. You better get all the choices. But a lot of the choices just don't matter.
Like the mid-mission stuff?
Yeah, the mid-mission stuff doesn't matter. A lot of the base investigation stuff also not so much.
So tell us more about these mid-mission subplots.
I told you about them. They come in 5 stages, and they're basically always the same.
Oh.
It's these documents and audio logs that tell a story about the location and how aliens slowly or quickly took it over. And they always end the same way.
And that one deer that always gets away.
So, characters.
Yeah,
there's a couple characters in this. And some don't even, like, have much to do with anything until the very end.
Yeah.
Like, Weaver.
Well, Weaver gets, like, a whole, like, story mission where she's kind of... the capture access mission, she gets a lot of spotlight there. That's where
Is there any other major female characters besides Agent Weaver?
There's the communications operator.
Does she get her own mission?
No. She gets a base investigation early on.
That was that mission where you have to go in that really loud room and you can't hear squat.
Yeah. Turns out 1962 radio equipment is loud.
I think we were making fun of that throughout the whole time.
What?
Because it really was loud. I think
one of our actually okay jokes in that LP.
I can't remember exactly how we did it, but it was something along those lines.
I think that was just basically it.
I can't hear you. I don't think she can hear me. Oh yeah, that's
she's in the room with all those turning gears, basically.
In essence, and I think just in general to. Summarize every one last thing in my notes about the gameplay that I can't believe I forgot. Recon agents are obscene because their final power is the orbital mortar strike or something, the fire mission. You remember that, where you just lay down?
And we just don't get an explanation as to why they have.
In the very first mission, you get a level 5 recon, and they have that. It's just so overpowered because it's just a bombardment. Of admittedly a small area, but also like it's the final mission. We're on a space station. How are you arranging this mortar strike?
It works even indoors
or inside a building or underground. How? And it's just like, just don't ask. Don't even ask.
It's magic.
It's our space magic. But how?
It's magic. We don't have to explain shit.
a lot of agent stuff just kind of comes and goes. You get the lift out of nowhere in the second mission.
Maybe it has something to do with the twist.
Well, maybe it's that magic.
For Carter, I think it's that magic is fine. But for like the other agents, where it's very clearly more, this is based off of our technology that we've learned, it doesn't fit story-wise.
Actually, well, I thought that.
What they really mean is the twist is doing everything.
I don't think the twist is doing everything is the thing. I think it's more about those characters. But anyway, I think
No, it's not. I actually wanted to bring up before we switch off that. I thought the reason he did the lift thing was because of that gauntlet thing that was strapped to his arm.
Oh my god, the vent brace! I realized I wanted to talk about this. So the vent brace is that gadget that's. You know, has all those cords on your right arm and has the gauntlet.
The thing that looks, it's like a proto Pit Boy.
Exactly. And it's set up in dialogue as this thing that allows you to pick up enemy weapons and perhaps capture enemies. So in a more randomized XCOM game, this would be the equivalent of the arc thrower. But for most of the game, it's basically just a throwaway line to justify why you can pick up enemy weapons and use them. And also, it makes your fist glow when you do the rare melee attack.
Because as we know, glowing is power.
Exactly. Except for one scene in the, you know, third to last mission where you actually use it to capture an alien. And it's like, oh, you could do that with that? Like, that's the only time it comes up where you actually use the Venbrace for that.
Well, to be fair, the alien is energy-based.
True, but there's apparently the implication that you were going to capture the other more physical alien with that.
Oh, fair enough.
Well, there was also, like, the you know, in fairness to this game, you know, the whole picking up enemy tech in Enemy Unknown doesn't really work because after enemy deaths, you know, the weapons, you know, just self-destruct.
Yeah, so it's like, so when you finally find one, it's like, oh, I guess this one didn't magically. And then they start dropping very regularly. Like, there's just...
That's right, you don't really develop the weapon, you just...
No, if you find it and then you have an infinite supply of it, congratulations. You can give it to all of your guys the next resupply station you get to. Like, it's just, there's gameplay... As far as, like, ludonarrative, there's a lot of lazy plotting that's not... that, and there's not enough throwaway exposition to really cover it all up. Like, the first time you encounter a muton or a sectopod... when the scripted line says, you know, your squad mate's going, what the hell is that thing? Then immediately after they shout out, oh god, it's a muton! Because that's their scripted line for the gameplay. Or, oh god, it's a sectopod. Oh, we got a sectopod. And I'm like, oh, you shouldn't know that.
Within seconds of the other thing?
Yeah, within seconds right. of the other line of dialogue.
So you don't get an interbridging dialogue.
No, it's just, you have the scripted line, which is what the hell, and then the gameplay line. The gameplay call out for those characters, which is,
right.
Oh, they're calling out the special enemy. They want you to notice that.
But Bubba's added a new thing.
Oh boy. I'm not. Stop pointing those out. I can't put them on the video. Save image as. So yeah, like the little narrative and the game narrative in a lot of ways doesn't match up. Which is kind of a little important to me as someone who's interested in specifically game storytelling. Like, that's sort of just a very specific area of passion that I like so much, and it's kind of disappointing on those levels. But it's, you know, it's a spin-off game that is mediocre reviews, so it's like, what are you expecting from this game? Which brings us, I think, to the ending. Which is such a surprise. And
dun, dun, dun.
If you want to see a summary, if you want to see the reason why I did this whole why I wanted to do this whole let's play, but
oh, you knew about this going into it.
Well, yes, because I'd played the game before.
Oh, you played the game before you even did the let's play.
Yeah,
with us? I did not know this.
You thought I was...
What else have you been keeping from us?
You thought I was going in blind?
I don't know, maybe.
Did I... well, okay, you thought that maybe I'd only played a few hours?
Partly blind, yeah.
No, right. I played the whole thing. The whole reason I wanted to do this LP was because of this...
The twist.
The twist. So...
Are you going to put the twist on?
Yeah, I'm putting the twist on the stream.
Okay.
So basically what happens is that after you... supposedly
skip to the 20
yeah the 20
minute
25 minute mark.
Yep.
Basically what happens is that after you've supposedly beat, you know, taken out the major general of the invasion, you discover that you are not controlling who you thought you were, and that you're actually playing a benevolent ethereal that has been controlling William Carter this whole time.
It was a twist.
It's a very sort of...
that I wasn't expecting.
It's a very, I'd say, Bioshock-style sort of twist, which makes sense because it shares a director with Bioshock 2, and it's made by, you know, by one of the many arms of 2K. And Irrational was also part of the project very early on at one point. It's got a lot of Bioshock DNA in it. But after, I have to stress, after 8 hours of this drudgery, to have this twist come completely out of left field is just kind of mind-blowing. And the thing you start to realize is that this is actually... this has been set up when you actually look over the rest of the story. You have the case at Groom Range, which is kind of forgotten about it until this point.
I thought it had something to do with, like, all the, you know, energy manipulation that you have with the gauntlet and everything.
Yeah, there's that too. Like, that stuff still kind of makes sense in a certain context without this ethereal twist. But then, like, that's how you construct a good twist, is that you put up red flags that make enough sense in context, but really kind of add another layer when you look at them back. Like, there's, after, in chapter 4, there's this, no, after the tower, after the Titan boss fight, there's a scene where you get screened by the Doctor's new screening infiltrator process.
Right.
And Carter has a adverse reaction. And then, you know, like, the next scene, they can't figure out why, so it was like, oh, he's probably fine, and then they let you walk around the base freely. There's no more ceremony than that. Like, oh, he passed out, I guess he's not one of them. But when you're talking with Dr. Heinrich later, he said, you know, he asks, like, what was going on there? Like, what was your reaction? And Carter says, it felt like someone was... Yeah, I was driving a hammer into my skull trying to break free. And that line says to me, like, maybe... Because there's so many things that tie into this. Carter has a problem with authority, has a problem with not feeling like he's in control. There's these scenes with him in the dreams where he's sitting in the chair in the dark room and it feels like he's not in control. And afterwards, he's like... He gets really mad at the ethereal, at you, because I feel like this is an allegory for the relationship between players and player characters. He gets mad at not being in control, at feeling like a patsy for being not himself, but this fusion, rather, this whole time. And he actually rebels against the ethereal. He threatens to take out the whole base unless, you know, he is allowed to go free.
And you actually sort of play from the viewpoint of the ethereal during a lot of that.
Yeah, the whole mission leading up to that point is Carter kind of trying to resist, because now he knows what's going on, and he doesn't want this to be the status quo anymore. Even though his superiors are like, oh, the ethereal's been, like, actually an amazing asset this whole time, please bring it with you.
Well, I mean, I can see both sides of that. I mean, you know, nobody wants to be someone's puppet, but...
What I find really interesting is that it basically subverts the whole, the character with the drinking problem is the hero. Because
it isn't, in this case.
Yeah. Usually you have, that guy is going on a redemption arc, and it's like, oh, this guy is troubled, he's a loose cannon, whatever, but he gets the job done. But even in his file, in his report, J. Edgar Hoover at the time has an addendum in that file saying, this guy used to be, you know, hot stuff, but now he's destroying himself and he's basically only good as an expendable asset. But during the game, he's not only exemplary, but also, like, even tempered. There's a part where you can interrogate one of the infiltrators, and instead of, like, beating him within an inch of his life like everyone assumes you will, you can totally diplomacy him. Totally nice, and everyone's just like, whoa, we did not...
I think you actually did that.
Yeah, I did that in my Let's Play, and I don't think I'm afraid I don't really have the footage anymore, but it just takes everybody by surprise. And in the context of this twist, it feels like, well, okay, so that wasn't really what William Carter would have done?
It's the ethereal controlling him.
But, and then there's the stuff where after the mission, after Carter rejects the bond, you then can form a new bond with one of three other characters, Dr. Weir, Myron Falk, or Angela Weaver. And you, for the last base visit and the last mission, that is your player character, but they are aware of it. And they have things to say about that relationship in the last base visit. That's really interesting.
I love
well, I think it's right because here. You, as the ethereal, decide more to partner than to
be
really control, I guess you could say.
There's also lines during like the discussion between the two ethereals that's sort of the reveal, where Asaru, the ethereal character you're playing as, is more like, I didn't even realize I was here. I just thought I was William Carter. I guess that's not who I am, am I?
Right.
So he was just kind of in a larval form, and their relationship was more of a symbiosis. They both thought they were William Carter, except not quite. It says a lot about that relationship without going beyond allegory or metaphor. It
just kind of is what it is.
It is what it is, and even the characters afterwards, they say stuff about, like, all three of them, Weaver and Falk and Weir, all say, like, it's kind of strange. I am me, but I'm also the ethereal, and I'm also a combination of the two. Which if you were talking about, like, what is this thing that is a player is controlling, are they in the world, I feel like that's a good description of that.
Yeah, because the character reacts to your choices, but there's also still in character.
Yeah. So it is your actions and your choices and your sort of playing it, but it's also they're throwing their own spin on it. So it is them, it is you, and it's sort of the combination of both.
That's actually why I really like this thing, because it's a very high concept idea.
It's extraordinarily high concept, and it's something that really only it's one of those rare things that's less like a movie and more like a game. Because it's an allegory that is very specific to a game.
Yeah, you can't pull this off in something else, like a movie or something.
I mean, you can, but it's a totally different twist, where it's more like, oh, he was under control the whole time. And it's like, well, great, so I guess that makes him the bad guy. But in the game, it's like, no, actually, I was actually fighting for you guys the whole time. And so instead of being like this deconstruction that's accusing, like, you know, Spec Ops The Line, Undertale to a certain extent, the Stanley Parable, like a lot of these games in the past few years that have really examined the relationship between the game, the player, and the player character, this is sort of an elevation as well as sort of a criticism, where it's like, you are the hero. Not that this player character really, like, appreciates that, but that's also because he has very personal problems that were suppressed while you were in control.
Or they were there, they were just not as...
Or yeah, not as
prevalent.
Yeah, because he was not fully himself, but that was also a positive thing. There's a lot of nuance in just this dynamic in the game that's super interesting from a writing perspective.
If only the rest of the game had been that.
I mean, that's the thing. What also makes this such a good twist, sadly, is that it comes out of nowhere specifically because the rest of it is so boring.
Well, as you said, there was a bunch of development problems throughout the thing. So this last section is, I guess, what they were trying to deal. But the other parts were made by other people or whatever.
I feel like this is, I think it was the other way around, really. I think this is something that they were desperately trying to, like, it's like, we gotta have something
salvage
to give it
the identity. Game.
Like, if there was one part that really got the most attention, surprisingly, it was this. They focused on the ending the most, which is weird. That's not usually how
it happens quite a bit in games nowadays.
Well, like, you focus on...
It's either it's in the very beginning or the very end.
Yeah, but...
They never really do a good job throughout the whole game.
I know, and that's just project management in general. Like, you focus on your inciting incident and then the end, but, like, usually it's a lot more, like, front-loading that happens than back-loading.
Than back-loading, yeah. It happens, though.
It happens.
I can think of a couple games myself. But you're right. It's mostly front load, and then they sort of just spatter around.
And they both have their advantages and disadvantages. Like when you front load it, it's like, oh god, they're putting all this, you know, putting it this right up front, you know, kind of showing all of its cards a little too early. But at the same time, you know, if you're invested in it, you know, you're going to want to keep going. Whereas when it's a surprise like this, you wonder if they'll even make it to the twist to even appreciate it.
Yeah, it.
Yeah.
And a lot of people didn't, because they probably just played this game and it's like, man, that wasn't great. And, you know, they...
There was a skip.
Yeah, I skipped in the live video.
Also, I didn't get a chance to bring it up, but I did like that line where he's shooting the tank with the other ethereal, and it's like, huh, I didn't think that would work.
Yeah, that, like, everything from that moment forward is just, there are just a lot of really interesting scenes, both on, like a meta-text level and the text level.
So, at one point, Carter basically fights you off, and you try to take him over, and he fights you off again, and then he basically plants a bomb, and he says, get out of me forever, or I'm going to blow us both up.
And you can he has it on a timer, and you can actually let that timer run out, and everyone dies, cut to credits, game over.
Right.
Yeah, he's not bluffing.
So the other thing is you let go.
Yeah. It's coming up right now, actually.
Yeah, you...
Is this the destruction? Yeah, this is the destruction.
It's
kaboom!
It's very disappointing, actually.
And then you choose one of the other three characters, which is really cool, but also... Like, because the last mission plays out, I wouldn't say totally differently, but there's a lot of unique dialogue for whoever's in charge, as it were.
Yep. Weaver is by far my hand pick for the person who sounds the most alien.
Yeah, her dialogue...
Possessed.
Her dialogue during the base visit. She actually gets a lot more natural during the actual final mission, but during the base visit, she really kind of goes all in on, I am merged with an alien. I talk a lot more succinctly, and I enunciate a lot more, and I sound more calm than I usually do, which the other two don't really do as much. They actually act more like themselves, which I feel like is, I feel like that was a bad move on her voice actor's part.
No, I liked it.
You liked it?
I liked it.
Well, Weir, I mean, Weir
also does a sort of like, now I'm somebody else also, but I'm also myself. It's really fascinating.
she becomes Spock for a little bit. Yeah.
Well, it's.
Oh no,
it's
I was talking about Weir's like. How he becomes sort of, actually, yeah, Spock, I guess, would work.
He's the one most open to the idea.
Yeah, he's, there's actually a couple of funny lines in Weir's path where it's like, okay, I guess we better go on. And they're like, wow, I never thought I'd hear that coming out of the good doctor's mouth. Enjoy the novelty.
Yeah, I did like his path, partly for that, and also because how his path.
How it ends. Out.
Because he kind of seems he's the most merciful out of the three of them.
Yeah, I actually kind of don't like this, but the choice you make about an hour before you actually realize that was the choice you were making is, do you have the good ending, the ending, or the bad ending?
It is sort of a meh ending.
Falks is just so middle of the road.
Yeah.
It's just like, well... the aliens are, we use them to rebuild, but then we kill them, and the sleepwalkers,
or something.
Yeah, and then the sleepwalkers, we didn't, like, murder them, but we didn't cure them, and we allowed them to pass away naturally.
Yeah.
So, like, okay, they're dead, but you treated them humanely. Good job. Whereas Weir is like, okay, we freed the outsiders, we allowed them to leave our home planet peacefully. We cured the sleepwalkers.
Cured
they did
all the sleepwalkers. Yeah. Nobody died. Yay.
Whereas Weaver, like,
Weaver's like, everybody dies.
Weaver's like, not only did I clean up all the sleepwalkers, I used the mosaic system to make the outsiders murder each other all at once.
Yep.
That one made me cringe a little bit. I was like, whoa.
Well, I have to give it to her of finding, like, a really useful solution for the mosaic. Like, if you're going to have...
It is unique, yeah.
Because with Fox Method or Weir's Method, you need to sort of hunt them all down, so to speak, to either free them or not. And Weaver's like, you know what? Let's just have them all commit suicide, basically. That way you don't have any
firing squad.
That way you don't have pockets of resistance or something like that left. So.
Well, yeah, but then you run the risk of, hey, maybe some of them didn't die, you know? I mean, well, statistical probabilities.
Because they either shot themselves or other people.
Or shot each other.
Yeah.
I don't know. I found that kind of, I was like, wow, she's putting a lot of faith into something that has plenty of random chance to it.
Well, Mosaic was implied to be designed to be basically inescapable. Perfect.
Which it was.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the whole reason why, like, the base sort of gets overrun and all of that other stuff is because they try to connect to it. And then which just
kind of comes out of nowhere, too. That kind of plot element, just like, it really is as sudden as it sounds. Like, well, we got to plug you back in. Why? Because
we're trying to find the main base, right?
Well, but like, they blew up the main base, but apparently they're still like, Origin is still around. And
well, wherever Mosaic's control center is, that's where you go.
That's what the previous mission was for. Is the thing is like, oh, we thought we won, but it turns out we didn't. So now we got to go back in to the network.
I think that's another plot hole.
It's a little bit of, yeah, that sudden re-raising of stakes is not, I would say, perfectly handled.
Okay, so seeing as how we didn't actually get there in the playthrough thing, and I was just watching the video you created, I didn't know that you already found where it was located. And so I thought that by plugging them in, that's where they were finding location.
I did some looking up on my own to try to piece everything together because I got whiplash from some of these scenes. So I was like, let me go with a fine tooth comb and try to pick some of the holes out. And yeah, that did seem, I was like, oh shit, we forgot about this guy that was still in the base. I think that was specifically the reason they did that.
Yeah, to tie up that loose end.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the little parts in the mission that change depending on what you do.
During the final mission?
Yes. During the final mission, there's like two or three branches, if you will.
There's two. There's two like branching points, I'd say. Out of Weir, Falk, and Weaver, one of them is your main character. The other two kind of assist you because you have to, for some reason, you have to go to these three locations and then shut down the final force field all at once or else you fail.
Right.
So you have the people split up and then you have to, then they get ambushed and you have to decide, well, which one are you going to go and support? And it's basically a who lives and who dies situation.
Going back to Mass Effect again.
Yeah, even though
it's the Vermeier mission.
It's at the last second. The death is sad, yeah, but it doesn't even get reflected in the final monologue or anything. So right. The choice is just kind of there. And I don't feel like it has a whole lot of narrative function. Like imagine if in the Mass Effect 2 suicide ending, like one of your guys was just guaranteed going to die, period. Like you didn't even have a choice in the matter. At least one was going to die.
I think there's someone that does die, but I'm like, wait, no.
I think they were trying to set it up that way, but in the end, I think they pulled that punch. Maybe. That's just been my theory about that whole thing.
Also, you have to tell the other person, like, well, you have to tell the other person as you're heading for one and abandoning the other. You have to say to them, I'm going after, you know, Falk first or whatever. And they're like, okay. And then they say, but Carter is going for you. He's on our side now. They say after Carter just totally betrays you and tries to get you killed. But what?
Yeah. What was that about?
That just comes out of nowhere. That's another plot hole thrown in.
For those that don't know or haven't watched the video and all of that stuff, Carter shows up again. The person you inhabit knocks him out to begin with, and basically puts him on the ship that goes to this place. And then he manages to escape because the rest of the people that you have guarding him just say, you know what, Carter's awesome. Let's leave him, like, let's leave him to his own devices.
Although he shoots the pilot on his way out, so it wasn't exactly a peaceful...
That's true, but the other people let him go, basically.
It's implied that some of the other soldiers were on the same wavelength as Carter.
Right. Well, I mean, because even the pilot says, you know, wasn't it Carter that did all this? And you have to keep reminding him, no, it was the Ethereal that did everything.
And so Carter becomes convinced that you are now this force that's out to enslave the world and you must be stopped, even though, like, all of humanity is on the line. Carter, do you have to do this now? And he's like, well, yes.
No, that's even a line. Is like, are we really doing this now? That's word for word.
Yeah. That's word for word. So that's the other branching path, is once you actually out of nowhere apprehend Carter, you now have to decide whether he lives or dies. And that also is a thing that just kind of doesn't get reflected afterwards. It's just a thing you can decide now. Either you walk away, they take him back to the ship, he's no longer a problem, or you kill him, everyone's shocked, and then you walk away and he's no longer a problem.
Either way, he's no longer a problem.
It's not in the ending either.
It's not in the ending monologue either.
I like to think that the best ending was you were with Weir, and you let Weaver die because she's just an expendable agent.
Alas.
And where Faust is the actual...
Faust!
Falk.
Yes.
Oh, Falk.
Sorry, I forgot his name.
I know, just comparing Falk to Faust is incredible, actually.
So, Falk...
He didn't make a deal with the devil, damn it.
is sort of like the guy who runs XCOM, and I'm like, if you know the world's coming back from the brink or whatever.
Yeah, in terms of value, in terms of valuation,
you want to keep alive, and agents are, I mean, even though they're not meant to die, technically, she is probably the most expendable out of the three of them.
Yeah. So as Weir, you
plus she barely has any. Thing on the plot anyways. Contribution.
she does for one mission, and that you guys didn't get to see.
Yeah, but the majority of the game, no.
Yeah, exactly.
Versus the other two, which are always doing stuff. Important stuff.
Falk.
And she's just there complaining about everything.
I've always imagined Falk as the guy actually playing Enemy Unknown in this version of the universe, where he's actually like building base facilities and choosing what research to pick.
Right.
And I was always, when I'm walking around the base, I'm like, why are you doing all these autopsies? Why aren't you rushing laser weapons and Titan armor?
When you do the autopsies, you get bonuses to the other researchers.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I remember.
But he was like, as soon as you kill something, you immediately get the autopsy. And it's like, you know...
Well, yes, at a certain point, you just get really good at doing the autopsies, and you can do them instantly.
Yeah.
But by that point, the stuff that you get from it is not really that useful, because you've already researched everything else.
Well, I just had this image in my head of, I was like, okay, we got to do all the autopsies, and then get a new guy, nobody likes him. So I was like, okay, we got a job for you, we want you to autopsy this, and it's a silicoid.
Well, who knows? Maybe they're like frogs or something, and they actually have organs.
The silicoids are implied to be the one you really unique and interesting enemy of the Bureau. These silicon-based liquid enemies, they're just, that's like all they are. It's not even known how they even come together.
They are the slimes of this game.
They are.
They're attack dogs. They're sentient blob attack dogs.
Which you can get one of your own, and it's interesting. It doesn't even do that much, but it's like, I love throwing it out there anyway. Because it totally distracts the enemy.
Anyways,
I would hope
Carter would live, but he's probably like a liability at this point.
But yeah, so the best ending is Weir, you save Falk, and you let Carter live, and everyone's happy for her.
Falk.
Falk, yeah.
Everyone's happy-ish.
And then at the end, it's like, okay, and then we did the cover-up, and that's why it's called Declassified, because all of this was stricken from the records. No one knows about the secret alien invasion of 1962.
And yep. Then it shows up again 50 years later.
And then they're like, oh, crap, they came back.
As a really mediocre game.
What? Are you talking about Enemy Unknown, right?
Oh, no. I meant the Bureau.
The Bureau.
Yeah. So this actually happened in real life, and then it was classified.
Until 50-something
years later, when they declassified it and made it into a game.
They declassified it as a video game, is what you're saying. Yes. In universe.
Because, and here's the ingenious part of it. Nobody is going to remember this game the next year.
Sir, we don't want to declassify these documents because they contain really sensitive materials. Oh, well, just make them into a video game.
Just make it a D-list game that nobody's going to remember the next year onward, and now it's done.
So they pull a Tropic Thunder, is what you're saying?
I guess.
that's incredibly cynical, but makes a certain amount of crazy sense.
Although... Now that brings up the question, the ethereal is still here. Who is he controlling now?
The ethereal departs.
Yeah, at the very end of the monologue for all three of them, they say, and what happened to the other creatures? Like, they left as soon as we wrapped things up.
Right, but it
location, status, and intent are currently unknown. The end.
So it still could be on Earth.
Yeah, but the camera kind of pans out to space from the planets, and the XCOM, like the classic XCOM theme, starts playing. So it's like, who knows?
Okay.
Although I like to think of it from a meta-text level as like they've moved on from this game and are moving on to the next. You know.
Yeah, that's actually what I was wondering. Is exactly what its relationship with the other games is? Is this like alternate universe like XCOM 2 is, or?
The thing that doesn't make it gel with the other XCOM games is the fact that you have these nice ethereals when in Enemy Unknown, probably XCOM 2 as well, they're the bosses of the alien invasion. They're the biggest bastards.
Yeah. That was sort of the same for the previous, like the original game also.
Like the ethereals are the big bads. They are the psionic masters of the alien army. And here there's
using their massive magical mind control powers.
Here, the
make everybody their slaves.
The main bad guy is just one of the outsiders who managed to like take control of one and
bend it to his will.
So the ethereals aren't even part of the power structure in this permutation of the outsiders.
Yeah, it makes me think that that's why this is alternate universe. I mean, granted, you know, I'm a big proponent of playing against type in D&D and stuff like that. So I can't say that all of them are, you know, psionic bastards and all that stuff. You know, that there's
it's just weird that that is the role of the ethereals in this game compared to other games. That all the ethereals you see in this one are, Shamash is kind of cutthroat after spending so long in prison. But Asara was like, they're all like, these are the nice ones. And we are on our own. We are beings of influence, you know, transcending time and space. We are not the bosses.
That's actually a really good summary of the plot. Leave before you become part of this M.C. Escher staircase of a plot.
So that's the part where the plot really doesn't gel with the rest of the series, because the ethereals have a totally different role.
In comparison to all the other games, XCOM and them.
Yeah. But I mean, just on its own, it's still just an amazing game twist that really has a lot to say about the relationship between the player and the player character. You have a player character that rejects the player. You have choosing a new player character and them being aware of that and having something to say about that sort of symbiosis, about how that's valuable.
Well, I mean, even within the series, it's kind of interesting because it kind of turns stuff on its head.
Yeah.
But
are you really the villain for basically taking away Carter and then later on either
did you destroy Carter Fox? Or was Carter already broken and he destroyed himself? Another interesting question.
I suppose you
are
you
talking about are you talking about the fact that he was like a drunk and all that foolish stuff?
Yeah, he was. Like, he was
prior to the whole briefcase incident.
Prior to the whole briefcase, he was still a functional agent, but deeply, deeply troubled.
He was a functioning alcoholic, which is not a great. That's not a great spot.
Like his file tells the whole story of him on this steady decline from his glory days as this really good undercover agent. And, you know, resulting from the loss of his family and blaming everybody in his life for it. You know, just this general feeling of not being in control, wanting to help them, but being unable to. And the ethereal just feels like the ultimate symbol of that for him. He feels, you know, trapped in that chair. He is not the one in control, and he desperately wants to be for once. So his character actually takes on a new dimension in that light. But I also feel like he becomes kind of what everyone feared he would be from his file.
Like a trainer in their Pokemon, only the Pokemon is an alcoholic.
That is an interesting idea.
That's fucked, Nick.
Talk to Dr. Weir, I choose you. There's this weird...
Well, I mean, that's... You're giving orders and stuff, and like...
What's that weird David Cage game where you can potentially jump to a bunch of other characters? It's like one that nobody has ever heard of.
Let's see, I know about...
the one where you play as, like, an angel or something like that?
Omicron the Nomad Soul.
Something like that. Yeah.
I have no idea what that... Hold on, let me look that up.
It's...
Let's see. Okay, let me see. I don't.
We can look that up later. I mean, it's...
Oh God, I've never
when you first go into your command window, I guess you could call it, when everything turns blue and really slow.
Mm-hmm. That's battle focus. Yeah.
Yes, the battle focus. When you first do that, after taking control of one of the other guys, they comment on the fact that, oh, this is why he was able to like. Be so good with his squad mates. It's because the ethereal was like communicating in real time or whatever
in really fast motion, which kind of raises the question why your squad mates never were like in their reports be like, yeah, Carter gave out his orders at hyper speed and that didn't raise any red flags. But again, the squad mates aren't really characters. They're
up to that point. The game never talked about it. So it wasn't. So you just thought it was a part of the whole, you know, game.
Yeah.
And no, it was. It was honestly leading up to the ethereal subplot.
Yeah, exactly.
Honestly, the way I look at it as is kind of, it was kind of he was doing like those things that you see like really tight military groups do where they just kind of know, but
they do the little hand signals.
Not even do that. It's just. You know, they can just kind of read and play off each other just based on what they're doing. I imagine something like that, but it's some kind of like, you know, some kind of higher level thinking thing that I'm probably not even capable of comprehending. But I kind of figure it's like he's doing the micromanagement, but making it look like it's like, okay, they're just that well oiled a machine. Which is really funny considering how little damage the squad does.
Yeah. Another kind of callback that I really like is during the reveal scene when the two ethereals are talking to each other. The question is asked, what is your first recollection? When did you first have control? And he says, it was right after Carter was dying and you know, calling out for help. And the first moments where you actually have control in the game is when he wakes up in that hotel room after you know, almost dying. That was,
and then saying something about the fact that, oh,
the gunshots healed.
My wounds are healed.
And then, you know, he starts out with the heal power, which goes completely unaddressed or explained, but just like no one asks, like, oh, you can heal people? Yeah.
It's game mechanics.
You know, I guess the thing in the briefcase helped me out, and now I have this power, I guess.
Right.
Maybe he had already started drinking right before that. It's like, oh, I can do this now. That's the thing.
But, yeah, it's like, it literally is, like, when did you first have control? Well, actually, there. And it's like, the moment you first had control as the player in the game.
Right.
It's just, that part of everything actually had a lot of effort and craft into it as ludonarrative. Everything else, like we were talking about, what, half an hour ago now? Not so much. So it really comes out of left field that this is just so very, even objectively, pretty darn good.
So, winding down, do you believe that the whole ethereal subplot thing at the very end of the game saves the game?
I think it elevates the whole game. And I'm really still debating in my mind whether it saves it. Like, I am, to this very moment, I'm like, I kind of like it, I kind of don't. Like, it's still a slog to get through, even on normal difficulty, if you're not on board with that. I would almost recommend this game, but that's why I made the Path of the Prisoner video. It's like, here is actually the interesting part of this game that I really want to talk about. Here's the whole summary of it. The game, if you want a third-person XCOM-styled shooter, okay, if that's what you want, that looks interesting to you, you know, yeah, fine, go play it. I wouldn't say it's great.
If you want to play it.
I wouldn't say it really stands out. It's, but God, going through it again was really interesting for a while until it started getting bogged down in the really kind of lame missions, because I was seeing all this stuff again in a new light, going, wow, that's a call forward. That's foreshadowing a little bit. So, but yeah, that's why I just summarized it into the video, is because, like, I don't know if after so long the game becomes totally worth it, but boy, does the whole game become a bit more interesting. It elevates it.
At the very end.
At the very end, yeah. I mean, I'm on record as saying, like, you know, your ending, your climax is God. It either, you know, shines a light or casts a shadow on the rest of your story. And this one certainly casts a light. I just am really still debating with myself whether it makes up for all the ways the game is so okay it's average.
To be fair, at the time of this recording, it's on sale for $4.
Hey, the lunar sale. Let's go ahead and date this one.
In all seriousness, it's not. Even at full price, you could do a whole lot worse.
You will get a solid 8 to 10 hours. It will not be the best 8 to 10 hours of your life, but it will fill the time.
I think it's also
not terribly optimized on PC either, is the thing. You'll need a fairly chuffy machine. And even on my computer, it got a little interesting to record at points.
So you would give it a solid meh out of 10?
Well, I mean, you really, like, find the Metacritic score or any of that, and I will basically agree with whatever that says. Like, it's, like, a D+. I really want it to be a C-.
The Metacritic is 66 for reference.
Yeah.
66 out of 100.
But I'm really debating.
So it is almost a C.
Yeah.
D+ yeah. It is.
I'd give it, like, with the ending elevating the whole thing, I'd give it a C, but it's really just so mediocre at times. It hurts. It really drags in parts. Like,
as someone,
and not like, even not even like the kind of filler where it's like you could just kind of get through it, whatever. It's more like, wow, it just nothing of substance is really happening. It's just going through these motions, these very cliche like motions.
That sounds like a lot of games nowadays.
It kind of is.
They're just going through the motions.
I mean that's a common complaint with all media, is that it's lacking in substance and just going through motions that are really boring. But in this case, it's actually a fairly valid complaint.
I think also part of the problem is that it's tied to another IP.
Yeah, so and
if it was its own thing, would it have been like if it did not have XCOM in it or anything?
I think it might have. I think in terms of development, it might have had fewer creative schisms, as some reports say. It might have ended up a more cohesive game. But if you were to just say take this game, but somehow it stands on its own without XCOM, I'd say it'd be Mass Effect 2.5, but bad.
Turns out I was right about the date. It is 1962.
Yeah, no, I memorized that freaking year.
So, what are we doing next time? What are we doing? A Let's Play in the future?
Well, right now. As far as what I've got lined up personally, now that this will be finally freed up, I can focus more entirely on Dark Sector, which I've left alone for months, that I do want to actually finish, but that's a solo effort.
Yeah, my question was more, do we get to, commentate on something in the future? Because everybody knows that we bring the fans.
Oblivious and Azureink, my superstars of my YouTube channel that regularly gets all of 50 views on every video.
It's amazing.
Oh, I am such a D-lister, it hurts.
That's 49 views more than you would think.
There are YouTube channels that upload gaming videos regularly that get all of 7 views, so I'm not on that level.
Everybody starts somewhere, right?
Yeah, it's just that this isn't my main thing. It's just something I do as a hobby for the passion of it. Because I want
an ethereal to like take control of you
to supercharge my Let's Playing abilities.
Yep.
Oh god, if I could have just some symbiote that lets me do all of my projects better and faster and simultaneously somehow, I would not turn that down. I would not turn that down at all.
Are you hearing us? What the hell's its name?
Asaru.
Asaru. If you're out there somewhere,
come
really
back and possess Newbiespud.
If you're out there and you're really bored,
good.
I mean, I was joking about this in the comments, but somewhat joking. I really did want to go through that Alpha Protocol thing that I've been meaning to do, but I bricked my last hard drive.
Alpha Protocol is, shall we say, not the best programmed game.
No, it's not. Although it didn't break my machine like it did yours.
It nearly bricked both my PS3 and my PC.
Yeah, I strangely enough, I didn't have that problem. I played it on I originally played it on Xbox, and then I got it like when it went on sale for $5 on Steam. It's one of those things that's like, wow, you got some like really good stuff going for you, but it does have a lot of problems too.
Yeah. I think that I'm kind of, what's the next thing on the play? I think the most likely candidate for my next Let's Play, where I'll actually have guests or rotating guests, is probably Driver San Francisco.
San Francisco.
Yeah. Another really interesting game with a really interesting story mechanic.
Yeah, that one's on sale too.
Oh, I would definitely recommend Driver San Francisco. It is a great little open world driving game with a really, nice. Not only like really good writing and really good characters, but also a really interesting mechanic to it. That's actually kind of like, that kind of is kind of like the whole like floating symbiote thing going on, but in a completely different context and without the whole fourth wall breaking thing. But yes, Drive for San Francisco. I think I want to do my next Let's Play of that after Dark Sector, because I think I'm only gonna. I was doing like two at a time for a while. I was doing, you know, Dead Space 3 and Binary Domain. I was doing, I was trying to do Dark Sector and the Bureau. I think I was doing like Metal Gear Rising and either Dark or Dead Space 3 and
doing multiple things allows you to like take a break out of one thing so that you can do another thing.
Yeah, but with how much editing goes into this stuff, it also adds just a lot of time to get one thing out.
Fair enough.
And after a certain point, when you've got so many projects going on, I've hit the point where I feel like I need to streamline it.
Okay, sounds good.
So that's what I've got on my plate as sort of the Let's Play thing, now that I'm not going to be doing this anymore.
Yay. Well, I mean, you're still gonna be playing XCOM 2.
Oh yeah, but that'll be I'll be streaming that if I do any of that, because it still makes my computer overheat like nobody's business, and I can't even record it for more than an hour at a time, so I can't do a Let's Play of it.
Maybe you should get one of those meat lockers and set in it with the with all the ice and stuff. And that way you won't overheat because your thing will be frozen.
I wish I had that kind of budget.
Okay.
He also needs a really open-minded meat locker.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you want to make sure that it doesn't lock when you close the door.
Yikes.
Well, sit in there with your coats on.
It's also not really the best, shall we say, recording environment.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I imagine the acoustics are really crap for that. But as far as locking yourself in a freezer, that's kind of like not really a thing nowadays, because nearly all freezers have a thing where they open on the inside too. Like, basically, in order to lock somebody in a freezer, somebody has to prop it from the outside. But that's just from me working in freezers for like nearly 10 years.
Oblivious, are you still doing LP stuff? Or have plans to do more LP stuff? Or,
well, that's why I brought up the Alpha Protocol thing, because
you can have us on your show.
yes, I can. Because what I was planning on doing is, it's got kind of, you know, without saying too much about it, one of the great things about it, it's got kind of a dynamic perk system, and all the stuff stacks based on your performance during the missions and the choices that you make. So it's actually a really good system that I would kind of like to see put in an even better game.
Okay, I think we've taken enough of people's time.
What's my recording at? It's been almost 2 hours. Oh my god.
Yep.
Wow.
Yeah, I've been actually watching the second tick by.
Wow. There was a lot to talk about when it comes to this game. I figured that was the case. But
now nobody has to play it because we've just basically explained the whole game.
we've spoiled all the best parts. And
I like to think that you should do pretty much everything, like you should experience everything and make your own conclusions and stuff.
I think the experience of like that moment where you have played through this whole game and then the end game kicks in is still kind of a special moment, pretty uniquely delivered. And you know, if you can pick up the game for like a few bucks and don't mind wasting your time on another third-person shooter, go ahead. Otherwise, you could probably live without it. We've talked about all the things that are worth discussing about it, in terms of both its place as a game narrative and its place in the XCOM franchise. So
we've given you the best and worst case scenarios with this kind of thing, and make your own judgment from there.
Like, I decided to abort a really thorough, in-depth Let's Play of this game, and, you know, make of that what you will.
Well, I think you would have still been recording had you not done that.
Yeah.
Because, like even leading up to this, you said, I'm finally done recording all the footage. Crap, I still have that to do.
Yeah, I was... To make the prisoner video, I had to record, a whole bunch of the game over again. So I've put way more hours into this game that's even insane. And I don't even have, there's, a bit of DLC called Hangar 6 R&D, where you play as Da Silva in a prelude to the game that's supposed to be kind of odd, but not really consequential. And I don't even have that, and I've still put so many freaking hours into this game.
Okay. Well, this is Azureink signing off. I hope to see you again in the future.
Yeah, thanks for joining on this, you guys. I was originally going to make this a much shorter video and do it solo with a script, but then I thought, I kind of shouldn't cut you guys out of the project like that after all the work we put in.
Yeah, it happens.
It would have been your decision. I mean, you're doing most of the heavy lifting with
but
this.
I feel like this covered a lot more ground.
Well, hey, it was 2 hours as opposed to 30 minutes, so...
I would have tried to make it even shorter than that, but...
Well, I was aiming high with that one.
Yeah. So I think, that will be it for Let's Not Play the Bureau XCOM Declassified, but the ending is amazing, and I hope we've convinced you of that, I guess.
The
ending is.
I mean, if you want to see it for yourself, if you haven't yet, I've got a video up on my channel that I uploaded about 6 days ago called The Bureau XCOM Declassified Path of the Prisoner, which basically shows all the relevant scenes we talked about, and also compares and contrasts the different dialogue in the three main endings. So it's basically like a movie of the game. It's like 96 minutes, dear God.
Okay, I'm signing out again. Signing out.
All right.
And this is Oblivious signing out.
Another freaking spud face image.
I wasn't going to say anything.
This is Newbiespud signing off, then. Thank you for listening.